All right, so today I'm going to talk about cognitive constraints on how we think about science and religion. And in particular, I want to talk about cognitive constraints on our understanding of the foundations of scientific claims and the foundations of religious claims. And I will be building off of some of the work that Paul was talking about with kids, following that up with adults. So I want to start off with the observation that from a superficial point of view, science and religion seem to be totally different worlds. Totally different spheres of human activity. They involve different instruments, different actions, different clothing, and they seem to have different ultimate goals as well. As people like Stephen Jay Gould have pointed out, science is concerned mainly with facts and religion is concerned mainly with values. Science is a method of inquiry, religion is a method of living one's life. But despite all those differences, there is one key fundamental overlap between science and religion, which is that both offer explanations for how the world works. Both are making empirical claims. And these explanations overlap in their form and their function. So in particular, what I mean is that both science and religion attempt to explain observable phenomena that affect our lives, in terms of unobservable entities. And because those explanations evoke unobservable entities, they are oftentimes difficult to verify through firsthand experience, firsthand observation and experimentation, sometimes even impossible. So as an example, consider the observable phenomenon of death. Religions often explain death in terms of the unobservable process of a spiritual transformation where we end up in an unobservable afterlife. Science, on the other hand, explains this observable phenomena in terms of the breakdown of unobservable bodily organs. And let me know, they're not unobservable in principle, obviously, but they're unobservable to the average person. If we turn to consciousness, religions often explain consciousness in terms of an unobservable soul, the seat of personal identity, whereas science explains consciousness in terms of the unobservable workings of neurons in our heads. And then with respect to biological adaptation, many religions explain this in terms of some unobservable act of divine creation, whereas science explains it in terms of unobservable processes like natural selection and descent with modification. And death, consciousness, and adaptation are just a few of many phenomena that both science and religion try to explain, phenomena that cover both the physical world and the biological world. So this similarity in the explanatory goals of science and religion has been noted by many people for a long time. One of the first people to articulate this overlap very nicely was James Frazer in the book The Golden Bough. And in that book, he wrote, "The analogy between the magical and the scientific conceptions of the world is close." And here I'm likening magic to religion, maybe contrary to what Jackie was hoping that we would disentangle. But actually throughout, I'm going to sort of transition from religious beliefs to supernatural beliefs, because the study I want to talk about is really about supernatural beliefs more generally. So anyways, the analogy is quite close. In both of them, the succession of events is assumed to be perfectly regular and certain, being determined by immutable laws, the operation of which can be foreseen and calculated precisely. Both of them open up a seemingly boundless vista of possibilities to him who knows the causes of things and can touch the secret springs that set in motion the vast and intricate mechanisms of the world. So in short, there's an inherent tension between science and religion in that they both offer competing explanations of the same phenomena. And this isn't great from the point of view of convincing the general public to accept scientific claims or to understand scientific claims, because as many people have shown and as Bob articulated earlier, religious explanations are generally easier to understand than scientific ones. And this is true in many domains where the two are offering competing explanations. Just to give you one simple case in point, and when it comes to biological adaptation, the religious explanation entails a single process, a well-understood process of intentional design, whereas the scientific explanation entails a combination of four independent processes, variation, inheritance, selection, and time. And there have been lots of empirical studies demonstrating that people really do have a difficult time with the scientific explanations, but don't seem to have as much difficulty understanding the religious ones. So religion seems to have the upper hand when it comes to the comprehensibility of the explanations on offer, but science certainly has the upper hand when it comes to grounds for acceptance. the evidence in favor of scientific explanations is far superior to that in favor of supernatural explanations, both from a qualitative point of view and a quantitative point of view. And what I'm going to focus on for the rest of the talk is whether or not the average person recognizes this fact. So I wanted to tell you about some research that we did in my lab, where the guiding question was, what kinds of considerations underlie the acceptance of scientific and supernatural claims? And how do those considerations relate to these three factors? Confidence in one's beliefs, one's scientific and supernatural beliefs, general overall acceptance of scientific claims, and understanding of the nature of science as a method of inquiry. And if you want more details about the data, you can find them in this reference. So in this study, we involved 140 college undergraduates from a couple of different institutions, and they answered five questions for each of six scientific entities and 12 supernatural entities. So these were our scientific entities: black holes, electrons, evolution, fluoride, genes, and X-rays. And these were our supernatural ones: angels, fate, ghost, God, heaven, hell, karma, precognition, reincarnation, saint and souls, telepathy. So they weren't all exclusively religious. And these are the questions that participants answered about each of those entities. First, do you believe in the existence of the entity? Second, why or why not? And so the participants' response to this question, which was open-ended, I will refer to henceforth as belief justifications. Third question, how confident are you that the entity exists on a scale from 1 to 7, with 1 labeled not at all and 7 labeled 100%? Fourth, approximately how many Americans would agree with you about the existence of the entity on a scale from 1 out of 7 Americans to 7 out of 7 Americans? And finally, what evidence might persuade you to change your mind about the existence of the entity? And I'll refer to participants' responses to this question as belief refutations. So these are the data for the scientific concepts. What you're seeing are the average existence judgments, confidence ratings, and consensus estimates. And for all 7 entities that we asked about, pretty much everyone believed that they existed. There was strong consensus among the participants that they existed. Participants were also highly confident in their beliefs, and they thought that most Americans would agree with them in the existence of these entities. These are the same data for the supernatural concepts. And they're rank ordered from most believed in to least believed in. And so on average, people endorsed the existence of half of these entities. And their confidence in these entities was lower. Their consensus estimates, how many other people would agree with them, was lower. Oh, and I forgot to mention that we're only looking here at data where participants said that they do, in fact, believe in the existence of the entities. So we filtered out all the cases where they said they don't believe in the existence of those entities. So these data already are parallel to the data that Paul presented, that adults, like children, differentiate these two two domains, the scientific and the supernatural, in terms of their confidence of their beliefs and their perceptions of general consensus surrounding these beliefs. But the real question was about the considerations underlying the beliefs. And so the first question was, why do you believe in these entities? And we sorted participants' responses using this coding scheme. So the first thing we did was to split the justifications for belief for mere clarifications for belief that didn't actually justify the belief itself, just clarify what, in fact, the person says they believed in. And then when we had our group of justifications, we split those into ones that cited subjective factors that really only related to the person's own point of view or personal experiences, from more objective considerations that could potentially apply to anyone. And then within the objective category, we split those into deferences to authority or some overall worldview versus citing some kind of empirical data. Those are the evidential considerations. So these are here's some sample justifications in each of those categories. Some sample subjective justifications: I believe in electrons because they make rational sense, or I believe in heaven because I like to think my loved ones are going there. The subjective ones almost always started with I, or had I in there, or an implied me. Here are some sample deferential ones: I believe in black holes because I trust my physics teacher, Mr. Murray, or I believe in hell because it's in the Bible. And some sample evidential justifications: I believe in evolution because there are fossils for past species, and I believe in ghosts because the stories about them are universal. So these are the justification frequencies by domain, and visually, you can see that the distributions are quite similar. The most common form of justification in both domains was a deferential justification. And participants did, in fact, provide more evidential justifications for their scientific beliefs and for their supernatural beliefs, but the difference was small. We're talking about a 10% difference. In terms of the refutations, belief refutations, we sorted them with coded them with the same coding scheme. The only difference was that the first cut wasn't between refutations and clarifications, it was between refutations and denials. And what I mean by that is that occasionally participants deny that anything could change their belief. So we set those aside, and then for the remaining refutations, we split those into subjective, objective, and then within the objective, deferential and evidential considerations. So here are some sample refutations in each of those categories. Some sample subjective refutations. I changed my mind about x-rays if I found out that all my x-rays were staged, or I changed my mind about hell if I died and wasn't punished for my sins. Some sample deferential ones. I changed my mind about x-rays if a bunch of scientists said it didn't exist, or I changed my mind about Satan if the church said it did not exist. And some evidential ones. I changed my mind about electrons if an atom was found without them, or I would change my mind about karma if bad people started experiencing good things. And these are the frequencies by domain. So again, deferential responses were the most common type of response provided in the scientific domain. And then also, again, participants provided more evidential responses to the scientific items than to the supernatural items, but the difference was small, even less than a 10% difference in this case. Something that was quite surprising to us is that participants often deny that anything could change their mind about the existence of scientific entities, almost as often as they made those claims about supernatural entities. So participants did not conflate these two things, and they didn't treat scientific and supernatural beliefs identically. They did provide more evidence in support of their scientific beliefs, but the size of that difference was small. So just to give you a sense of that, here I've got some Cohen's D, which is a measure of how large an effect is. And this is the effect of domains, science versus the supernatural, for the provision of evidential justifications and the provision of evidential refutations. Compare that to the size of the effect for confidence ratings and consensus estimates. So when it came to confidence in one's beliefs, the participants were much more strongly differentiating the two domains than when it came to actually citing evidence in support of one's belief. The same thing for consensus estimates. In fact, when we looked specifically at confidence ratings to try to see whether confidence ratings were related at all to a participant's ability to cite evidence in support of their justifications, they weren't. The only thing that predicted a participant's confidence in their beliefs was their consensus ratings. So the more often they saw other people agreeing with them, the more confidently they held their belief. It had nothing to do with being able to cite evidence. And the last set of analyses I'll tell you about are where we looked at predictors of evidential reasoning, so providing evidential justifications and evidential refutations. And we looked at those data with respect to participants' overall belief in supernatural entities, so the total number of entities out of 12 that they said they believed in, and also a measure of the understanding of the nature of science. So this was a separate measure where we looked at participants' understanding of science as an empirical, inferential, epistemic, tentative, and cumulative enterprise. And we derived this from previous literature on this topic. So with respect to supernatural belief, we found that participants with more supernatural beliefs cited less evidence in support of their scientific beliefs, and accordingly, they deferred to authority more often when justifying their scientific beliefs. And this was true not just for justifications, but also for the refutations. And when it came to understanding the nature of science as a method of inquiry, participants who understood science better cited more evidence in support of their scientific beliefs, and accordingly, they deferred to authority less often when talking about their scientific beliefs. And again, that was true both for justifications and for refutations. So some conclusions. It seems that for many of us, our scientific beliefs rest on the same epistemic foundations as our supernatural beliefs do. Both types of beliefs seem to ground out in informants rather than information. We seem to privilege the source of information more so than the content of information. At least that's what we naturally offer up as an explanation for our beliefs when trying to justify them to others. And it also appears that many of us lack insight into what may or may not warrant belief revision. It was quite surprising to us that participants claimed in 25% of cases that nothing could change their mind about the existence of electrons or evolution or black holes if they believed in those things. So I think that these data are well summarized by this New Yorker cartoon where one juror says to another, "I don't listen to the evidence, I like to make up my own mind." And that seems to be what's going on here, that evidence is playing a minor role in the acceptance of these kinds of beliefs. It's other kinds of considerations, mainly deferential considerations. And I'm just about out of time, so I'm going to skip over the cognitive implications and just hit on one last implications when it comes to education. This study was specifically looking at students' misconceptions about the foundations of science, but those misconceptions might arise from more general misconceptions about the nature of science, science as a method of inquiry. Certainly, we found correlations between these two things. The better you understood how science works as a process, the more likely you provided evidence in support of your scientific beliefs. And there's good theoretical reasons why this correlation exists. Deferential responses, the most common type of response in the scientific domain, they're consistent with what science education researchers call an engineering view of science, where you view science as a kind of, as a process of discovery or problem solving, not really as a process of inquiry or as a process of generating evidence. So if you see science as just about making discoveries, then it makes sense when justifying your scientific beliefs, you just defer to the discoverer or you defer to the problem solver. Whoops, sorry. And then secondly, many participants were not open to the possibility of belief revision in the domain of science. And this is consistent with others, with what others have found when it comes to views of what scientists are trying to do when they run experiments. Are they trying to provide support for their claims, or are they trying to prove their claims true? And so if you believe that electrons have been proved to exist, then the question of what would change your mind about their existence doesn't even make sense. So let me end there and open the floor to questions.